it is important that we address this issue of where is it that we are lacking. I mean, are we really happy with writing standards? I mean, objectively, not one is not raising fingers or accusing people of laziness or charlatangiri or anything like that at all. But the fact is that, yes, there has been a certain kind of screenwriting culture in this country. We haven't really had any conscious attention being paid to screenplay. For many, many decades, we've had stories, we've had dialogue. If you look at the earlier films, including Mother India, Mughal-e-Azam, you don't find a screenplay credit. But now it has become essential because we are also moving into modern screenwriting where we are no longer sort of constantly falling back on folk tales or folk theater or mythology or epics. So the point is, on the one hand, we're talking about internationalizing the Indian film, that so that we are able to reach, the narrative is able to reach across cultures. On the other hand, we do find that yes, professionally, writers have been a neglected lot. The script people have not, the film industry hasn't paid attention to the script function. No, it hasn't. You see that reflected everywhere, including in the media, including in publicity, everywhere. People are not aware of it. But the fact is, we are. We are. I mean, there has been an infusion of young, fresh talent over the last decade or so on a very, very healthy sort of basis. So therefore, I think it is time for us to really understand and do some bit of introspection here. Is that firstly, are writing standards a cause for concern? And if they are, can we understand where is it that we're falling behind? Can we try and formulate how to move ahead? So to lead it all, none better than the person who really burst upon the scene with the using the absolutely popular package and delivering scintillating screenplays, one after the other, the two Munna Bhai series. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rajkumar Hirani. Okay. Then, of course, the young Turk, whose work shines as much as his ball pit. The one and only inimitable, irreverent, irrepressible Abbas Tayarwala. Followed by Rajkumar Hirani's writing partner, who's equally responsible for the two scripts, for the two Munna Bhai scripts, who's been based in America. He teaches there, and yet look at the sort of what you call the talmel, which Raju here and Abhijat there worked out. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Abhijat Joshi. And fourth, but by no yardstick the least, we have a very important and interesting guest with us. I have especially requested him after several phone calls, insisted that he must come. This is a gentleman from Chennai who is a writer, director, having written several films which have connected with the critics, with the masses, with film festivals. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome S. M. Vasant. Thank you, Vasant. Now, in the position of the observer, we had Ashutosh Govarikar. I say we had, because I just received an SMS from him right now saying that his shooting's been in disarray because of the Mumbai episode, and it's just impossible for him to come, much as he would dearly like to. And he says that I am with you in spirit. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the spirit of Ashutosh Govarikar. Okay. Raju, we have some time, so we can explore the issue, but you have to make sure that the questions here are pertinent to this topic, because they can go all over the place completely. I'm sure you people are prepared. I'm not so sure about Abbas, because he's planning to shoot from the hip, but on this particular topic, I'd rather that he shoot from the hip. So Raju, over to you. Let's have a scintillating last session today. Thank you.
Good evening, guys. We'll try and keep it short. But don't. Okay. Is Saurabh Shukla here by any chance? No. No, because I remember a little anecdote which Saurabh told me a couple of years back. He said he had gone to Mr. Bachchan with a script, and Mr. Bachchan looked at the script and said, "Aajkal mere paas do hi kisam ke log aate hain." एक जो डीवीडी लेके आते हैं और बोलते हैं सर ये फिल्म बनानी है, और दूसरे किस्म के लोग हैं जो दो डीवीडीज लेके आते हैं, कहते हैं सर फर्स्ट हाफ इसमें से और सेकंड हाफ इसमें से. सो So is the Indian script writing, the scripting, a cause of concern? See, there, I personally feel there are divided opinions. A lot of people feel that now is the time when actually we are breaking away from the song and dance routine and making different kind of films. There's been a splurge of a lot of smaller films who've explored different subjects, which was possibly not possible a few years back. But at the same time, a lot of people feel still safe to do the conventional film where you still write on the shoots. And so there's a lot of conflict on that. And we have a lot of people who worked on this. There's Abbas, who's also now made a film. There's S.M. Vasant, who's been a writer-director. There's Abbas, there's Abhijat. Abhijat is actually a professor of playwriting in Ohio. He also writes. So I think let's begin with people, and then we'll open it for bashing up. So shall we begin with Abbas?
Yeah. Before I go on with what I exactly wanted to talk about, there are a few things that we need to look at. We keep talking about writers not having enough respect from producers, from executive producers, from channels. I unfortunately came straight from the airport. I missed a lot of the interesting stuff that must have happened before, but I happened to catch some of the television writing session that happened before this. And there was a great deal of outcry for getting more respect as writers. Presumably, we are saying this because we deserve respect. But I think we need to start by respecting ourselves and each other before we ask respect from anyone else. There were people making some truly, truly insightful points. I was very, very impressed with some of the points that Vinod put forward. And there are cell phones beeping, one after the other. We are not putting off our phones for something that we have gotten together for 2 days, taken time out of our lives to try and find, hopefully, a better future for all of us. But we can't even put forward the basic courtesy of putting at least our phones on silent if they are that important. We presume that we are more intelligent, more insightful. There's one for you. More intelligent, more insightful than channel heads, than creative heads, than certain people who've been named. Are we? Look at some of the responses that we faced. With all due respect to the gentleman over here who helped me with my bag, I'm sorry for getting into specifics. I normally take a lot of trouble not to. But I think you'll forgive me because you were pretty comfortable with specifics yourself. Why did you feel the need to say the things that you said? Simply because it was burning up inside you? Or did you actually feel that you had something new to contribute above and beyond what had been put forth in the session? I'm genuinely asking, it's not a rhetorical question. Was it because your words were bubbling up so much inside you that you had to put them out in that format without wondering whether those particular thoughts had been put forward to the audience? They had already absorbed it, and was there any need to put forward? Because almost 9 times, you said, as so-and-so said, as so-and-so said, as so-and-so said. In which case, what was the need to say it again? B, something is thrown open for questions, right? And out of the 6 questions, I heard 2 questions. One of them was a typical television deadline emergency, quickly think of a question because now I've been told to put this in the form of a question. Most of the, we are supposed to be sharper. And if we are not, then why do we need to be protected? We are supposed to have passion. If we don't, why do we need to be protected? How many writers over here have actually said no? No, I will not do it this way. No, I will suffer the consequences. No, I will take my chances. No, I know that I'm a better writer than this and that there's value to my work. And if this channel or this creative director does not understand it, somebody else will because I'm good enough. And so I say no to you. And then you've suffered. And then you haven't made it. And then you say, maybe I need to be protected. Or are we all just saying, so far, we've been too afraid to say no to anything because we need to protect ourselves. We want the convenient shortcut route out. But once you give us the basic protection, we will find the passion to say no. Once we can say no with impunity and it can't hurt us, then see how brave we are. We'll all say no. Please let me assure you from personal experience, I don't know any of the gentlemen in the television session personally, but all the people that were told that maybe you had it easy and maybe you weren't asked to write certain things and maybe you weren't subjected to it, let me assure you they all were. There's no other way of being where they are. Let me assure you, they all were, but at some point or the other, they took the trouble to say no. I know I took the trouble to say no a lot of times and lost out on a lot of opportunities, of money, and in a trade where no doesn't go down very well, often relationships. Are you willing to pay a price? If you are, if you have that passion, if you have that much belief in your ability, then of course you need to come together and be protected. But protection is not always for the worst amongst you. It's not always just because you're too afraid to do anything about it yourself. I would love to see a bunch of brave people who have taken a stand, and too many of you have suffered, actively suffered, not just the anticipation of suffering, not just the anticipation that there's a termination clause hanging on your head, not the anticipation that if this serial goes, then there'll be five other people who are willing to write equally bad stuff, so I might as well write bad stuff. If that is a mentality, then there's really a reason to explore, what are we protecting? Are we protecting mediocrity? Is that what this gathering is about? Are we saying we are not good enough, but that doesn't mean we don't need to be protected? Because hell, in every union, people are protected whether or not they are doing good work. You can't throw out somebody in catering from your film because the catering union will get on your ass. I've seen this. So you have to eat bad food. But yeah, we are protecting the guy who makes bad food. Is that the community we want to be? We must be very careful. Rajeshji, I'm very respectfully going to refer to your talk. We Indians have a bit of a tendency to take relief in laughter and fatalism. Hum log hasya mein sab kuch uda dete. Ho gaya, has liya, jo galiya andar thi, wo galiya nikal gayi. Shayad zaruri thi nikalni. Lekin us gali ke saath kafi kuch jo pehle kaha gaya, jo hamare liye zaruri hai, hamare liye seekhna zaruri hai, hame badalna zaruri hai, wo bhi us hasi ke saath chala na jaye. To ye bahut dhyan rakhna zaruri hai ki entertainment kahan tak hai, passion kahan tak hai, और क्या हमने सीखा और किस चीज पे हम अच्छा सोच बैठे. हाँ, बहुत सारी आई एम श्योर जैसे स्क्रिप्ट राइटिंग में, फिल्म राइटिंग के अंदर जो इश्यूज हमारे सामने है उतनी ही टेलीविजन में है, हर कम्युनिटी में है. लेकिन ना ही उसके सामने हमें इतना घुटने टेक देना है और ना ही उसे हंसी में उड़ा देना है. कहीं पर सिर्फ डर काफी नहीं है, कहीं पर थोड़ा गुस्सा चाहिए, कहीं पर थोड़ा पैशन चाहिए. और गुस्सा जब आप अफोर्ड कर सको, उस गुस्से का कोई मतलब नहीं है, फिर तो हर किसी को गुस्सा आएगा ना. तो प्लीज जरा सोचिए कि जो सारी चीजें निकल रही है उसमें आप किन चीजों पे खुश हो रहे हैं, किन चीजों में आपको एक रीअश्योरेंस मिल रहा है कि हाँ कुछ हो रहा है, हमें कुछ करने की या हमें कुछ बदलने की जरूरत नहीं है. प्लीज वॉच योरसेल्फ्स, बी केयरफुल एंड रिमेंबर ऑफकोर्स देर इज सफरिंग इन नो, बट योर नो इज योर बिगेस्ट वेपन एंड देर इज नो ग्रेटनेस विदाउट नो. आई प्रोमिस यू दिस. Thank you. Now coming to what I actually wanted to say. I'm sorry, I'm a bit of a reactive personality.
It's just a thought that came that yes. We Indians also romanticize suffering. We are a generation. We have made a profession out of it.
We'll come back to this question at the Q&A session. Let him finish what he wants to finish. We'll come back definitely to this question.
We'll definitely take your question first because I would like to address what you're asking. 2 years ago when we had the first scriptwriters conference, Javed Saab plagiarized one of my ideas. And therefore came across as the most intelligent speaker at that particular forum. How he stole my idea, I have no idea because I had not ever discussed it with him or anyone except a couple of my friends, but I refuse to think that he thought of it by himself. But I do remember when he said this on stage and me thinking, my God, I've been thinking about that. I can't believe he brought it up first. But it's true. When you look at script writing, when you look at stories, when you look at cinema, there will always be the few people that we remember as the great filmmakers, the great writers, the great directors, and all of us are hoping to get there. But fortunately, unfortunately, the bulk of the work will be your staple diet films. Ek tarah ki film hai har daur mein banti hai, jo kafi ek dusre se milti julti hai, kuch jo unka jo soul hota hai, jo unka basic conflict hota hai, wo aksar same hota hai. और उस दौर की सारी फिल्में उसी कॉन्फ्लिक्ट उसी स्टोरी के इर्द गिर्द घूमती रहती है. दो स्टेपल डाइट फिल्में, और ये वो स्टोरीज है जो बिना बहुत ज्यादा ब्रिलियंस के, बहुत ज्यादा आर्टिस्टिक एबिलिटी के, बहुत ज्यादा क्राफ्टमैनशिप के, हर कोई किसी हद तक अगर उसमें राइटिंग टैलेंट है तो लिख पाता है. इससे उनकी रोजी रोटी भी चल जाती है, उनका चूल्हा भी चल जाता है, लोगों को एक रेगुलर फ्लो ऑफ एंटरटेनमेंट भी मिलता है. नॉर्मली इस कैटेगरी में दो तरह की फिल्में होती है, होती हुई आई है. एक है गुड वर्सेज इवल, हीरो विलन, उनके बीच में एक संघर्ष किसी भी वजह से. ज़्यादातर तकरीबन आधे घंटे तक हीरो का बाप मारा जाता है, माँ के साथ कुछ होता है, भाई के साथ कुछ होता है, और फिर वो बड़ा होता है. और अब सारी फिल्म में आपको देखना है कि वो इस बात का बदला कैसे लेता है या जो भी. और दूसरा है लव स्टोरी, जहाँ पर दो लोगों के बीच में इश्क है और एज एन ऑडियंस आप उसमें इन्वेस्टेड हैं कि ये दोनों एक दूसरे से मिल जाए. आप बहुत चाहते हैं कि ये दोनों एक हो जाए, इनका इश्क सक्सेसफुल हो जाए, लेकिन कोई अड़चन है, कोई ऑब्स्टिकल है. ये दो सालों से, सदियों से स्टेपल डाइट रही है सिनेमा की. और बहुत जरूरी है कि देखा जाए कि ये स्टेबल डाइट क्यों चलती है, क्यों इतनी सारी कहानियां जो शायद बहुत ग्रेट राइटर्स ने नहीं लिखी लेकिन हिट भी हुई, आज भी हम शायद उनमें से काफी कहानियों को पसंद करते हैं और काफी कहानियां उस तरह की बनी. और इसकी पहले हम गुड वर्सेस इविल पे आते हैं, जो बात जावेद साहब ने कही थी कि आज हमारे पास विलन नहीं है. 60s में, 50s और 60s में जब आप किसी को एक सफेद चूड़ीदार कुर्ते में हुक्का पीते हुए किसी का नाच देखते हुए देखते थे, जमींदार बुरा आदमी, इसके सामने जो किसान का बेटा खड़ा होगा वो हीरो. 70s में जैसे आपको सफेद कोट और सफेद सूट और सफेद जूते नजर आए, आपको पता है एक सफेद टोपी भी अक्सर होती थी, मुंह में पाइप होता था, आपको पता है ये स्मगलर है. आपको स्मगलर क्या है, कौन है, क्यों है, क्या स्मगल करता है, समझाने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ती थी. वो डिफॉल्ट विलन था. बहुत छोटी छोटी चीजों से, बहुत छोटे छोटे क्यूज, बहुत छोटे छोटे स्टीरियोटाइप से आप उसे एस्टैब्लिश कर सकते थे. अब उसके सामने जो खड़ा हो गया वो हीरो. उसके बाद 80 के डेकेड में शायद पॉलिटिशियंस का दौर आया, जब पॉलिटिशियंस अब माने जाने लगे कि ये है. जब नेता की टोपी पहन के उस लिबास में जब कोई आता था तो दैट वाज अ विलेन. शायद बोफोर्स की वजह से अब ये हमारे नए विलेन हो गए थे, पहली बार वो जागृति आई थी. और 90s में रोजा के बाद से कुछ हद तक शुरू हुआ दौर टेररिज्म का. एट द टर्न ऑफ द सेंचुरी हमारे पास कोई विलेन नहीं था. टेररिज्म पे जितनी फिल्में बननी थी बन चुकी थी, अब और बनेगी, लेकिन तब तक जितनी बननी थी, जितना हम उसके बारे में कह सकते थे. और क्या कहोगे आप, कौन सी नई बात कहोगे. वही है, गलत है, बाहर से आते हैं, मारते हैं, उनको रोकना है, लेकिन अब कहने को कोई बचा नहीं है. आज के विलेन क्या है, कौन है, वो कौन सा शख्स है, वो कौन सा लिबास है कि एक आपके सामने एक झलक आई, आपको पता है ये विलेन है, और उसके सामने जो खड़ा हो गया वो हीरो है. वो कौन सी बुराइयां है जो आज बुरी मानी जाती है. चाहे हम कहें करप्शन है, कहां है करप्शन, इस कमरे में भरा हुआ है. कम्युनलिज्म, कम्युनलिज्म के जोर पे हम वोट करते हैं. हर वो चीज जो विलेन हो सकती थी. कॉम्प्रोमाइज, कॉम्प्रोमाइज हमारे घरों में है, हमारे परिवार में है, हमारे दोस्तों में है. हर वो चीज जो बुरी हो सकती थी, जो नेगेटिव हो सकती थी, जो विलेन हो सकती थी, वो आज इंस्टीट्यूशनल हो गई है. अगर आप कॉम्प्रोमाइज नहीं करते तो आपको हीरो नहीं माना जाएगा, आपको बेवकूफ समझा जाएगा, 5 लोग आप पे हंसेंगे. तो जो चीजें बुरी मानी जाती थी वो आज इंस्टीट्यूशनल हो गई है. कम्युनलिज्म जो विलेन हो सकता था आज हर जगह, हर पॉलिटिकल पार्टी, हर बेसिस में है. हाँ, कुछ लोग कहेंगे, लेकिन वो इंस्टीट्यूशनल विलेन नहीं है. तो कहां है इंस्टीट्यूशनल विलेन, क्या है. जमाना था कि अगर आप पैसे के पीछे भागते हैं तो आप विलेन थे, क्योंकि ये गलत था, इंसानियत बड़ी चीज है. आज अगर आप पैसे के पीछे नहीं भागोगे तो आप बेवकूफ हो. तो एक तो आपके पास विलेन नहीं रहा. अब आते हैं लव स्टोरीज की तरफ. लव स्टोरीज का एक बहुत ही सिंपल प्रमाइस हुआ करता था कि दो लोग को मिलना है, उन्हें रोक कौन रहा है, वो लोग अड़चन क्या है उनके मिलने में. चाहे वो माँ बाप हो, चाहे वो भेदभाव हो, जाति पाति हो, चाहे धर्म मजहब हो, चाहे इकोनॉमिक बैरियर्स हो, कोई अमीर है, कोई गरीब है. लेकिन जब नया मिलेनियम आया, एक वेस्टर्न इन्फ्लुएंस जो हम पर हावी हो गया सैटेलाइट टीवी के साथ, अचानक लोग बहुत ही इंडिविजुअलिस्टिक हो गए. परिवार का आपकी जिंदगी में दखल अंदाजी जो इतने सारे टेलीविजन सीरियल्स ग्लोरीफाई करने की कोशिश करते, फैक्ट ऑफ द मैटर इज कि बहुत सारी जो ऑडियंस है, खासकर जो हमारी मल्टीप्लेक्स ऑडियंस जिसके लिए आज सारी फिल्में बन रही है, उनकी जिंदगी में ये रेलिवेंट नहीं है. अगर आप किसी के साथ मिलना चाहो, अगर आप किसी के साथ शादी करना चाहो, अगर आपको किसी से इश्क हो गया है, तो आप देख लो, कोई कहने वाला नहीं है. या कोई कहेगा भी तो आप उनसे कहेंगे चुप रहो, ये हमारी जिंदगी है, ये हमारी जिंदगी है, ये बात शुरू हुई कुछ 2000 के आसपास, उसके पहले आप कह नहीं सकते थे माँ बाप से या अपने कम्युनिटी से या अपनी सोसाइटी से। लेकिन जैसे ये हो गया कि ये हमारी जिंदगी है और ये बात अब घर कर गई, अब दो लोगों को मिलने से कोई रोक नहीं सकता, विलन नहीं है, इश्क में अड़चन नहीं है। एज अ रिजल्ट हमारे पास डिफॉल्ट स्टोरी नहीं रही, मतलब वो 5% जो या 10% जो बहुत ही मोटिवेटेड पैशनेट और ब्रिलियंट राइटर्स है जो कुछ ना कुछ अपना जुगाड़ करते रहेंगे, वो अपना मुन्ना भाई खोद के निकालते रहेंगे, लेकिन हम जो करना चाहते हैं कि बस कहानियां लिखते रहे, अच्छी खासी कहानियां लिखते रहे, बहुत ज्यादा सोचना ना पड़े, लोगों को मजा आए, हमें लिखने में मजा आए, प्रोड्यूसर खुश, उसे साफ नजर आ रहा है कि ऐसी 10 फिल्में ऑलरेडी चल चुकी है, वो कहानी अब रही नहीं है। अब हर किसी को एक नई मुसीबत सोचना पड़ेगा, कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढना पड़ेगा। अभी स्टोरी ढूंढे तो कहां से ढूंढे, कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढे तो कहां, ये तो हर राइटर इतनी बात तो जानता ही है कि बिना कॉन्फ्लिक्ट के, और मैं ये भी कहता हूं कि मैं उस स्कूल से हूं जो बहुत ही स्ट्रक्चरल स्टोरी टेलिंग में विश्वास करता है, बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो बहुत अलग तरह का सिनेमा एक्सप्लोर करते हैं, बहुत बहुत ही कमाल का काम करते हैं, ये मेरा स्कूल नहीं है, तो मैं जहां अपना एरिया ऑफ इंटरेस्ट है, जो अपना जो मेरी पसंद है, मैं उसके बारे में बात करने की कोशिश करूंगा। तो मुझे स्ट्रक्चरल स्टोरी लाइन अच्छी लगती है, और अगर आप स्ट्रक्चर के हिसाब से एक बिगनिंग मिडिल एंड और एक स्टोरी में प्रोग्रेशन और ग्रोथ अगर आप देखना चाहते हैं तो आपके लिए कॉन्फ्लिक्ट जरूरी है। लेकिन अब बाहर से कोई कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आ नहीं रहा है, साफ साफ कोई कॉन्फ्लिक्ट नजर नहीं आ रहा है, तो अब हमें हमारे साइकोलॉजी के अंदर, हमारे इमोशंस के अंदर झांकना पड़ रहा है कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढने को। कॉन्फ्लिक्ट अब हमारे अंदर है, हमारे ही मोटिवेशंस में अब दो मोटिवेशंस निकल आ रहे हैं, हमें यह भी करना है लेकिन हमें यह भी लगता है, हमें किसी से इश्क भी हो गया है लेकिन हम कमिटमेंट से डरते भी हैं, हमें कुछ चाहिए लेकिन हमारे पास एक सोशल कॉन्शियस भी है। अब सब कुछ आपके अंदर से हो रहा है, लेकिन हमारे नैरेटिव ट्रेडिशन में शायद ही हमारा स्ट्रॉन्ग पॉइंट रहा ही नहीं है कि हम किसी चीज के जो ग्रेज है वो उसे उन्हें एक्सप्लोर करें। हमारी कथाएं, हमारे ट्रेडिशंस, हमारी फोक टेल्स, हमारा अब तक का सिनेमा, सब कुछ काफी हद तक ब्लैक और व्हाइट में साफ साफ नजर आता था, बहुत कम ग्रे एरियाज होते थे, और जब ग्रे एरियाज होते थे तो बहुत बड़ी बात हो जाती थी कि अरे बच्चन साहब ने नेगेटिव रोल किया, शाहरुख ने तो यानी नेगेटिव रोल्स का एक करियर बना लिया था, तो एक बहुत बड़ा एक इवेंट होता था कि जो मेन हीरो है वो कुछ नेगेटिव कर रहा है, तो वो अपने आप एक इवेंट था, बट दैट वॉज नॉट फाइंडिंग द ग्रेज विद इन आवरसेल्व्स। आज हमें हमारे मनोवैज्ञानिक एक्सप्लोरेशन करना पड़ रहा है कि ऐसी चीजें निकल आए जिसकी वजह से लोग दुविधा में है, और अब हम कहानी ढूंढने की कोशिश करते हैं, लेकिन ये हमारे कल्चर में नहीं है। इंडियन कल्चर में हर कहानी किसी तरह एक बच्चे की ओर डायरेक्टेड है। अगर गांव में अगर आपने कई नौटंकी के प्रेजेंटेशन देखे हैं, जैसे वो कहानियां ऐसे ही कही जाती है जैसे सारा गांव बच्चे है, वो सारे बच्चे हैं। बहुत कम कहानियों में कोई साइकोलॉजिकल इंसाइट या कुछ होता है, नहीं, एक बहुत ही मॉरलिस्टिक होता है। अगर डिवाइन इंटरवेंशन होता है तो उसका एक बहुत ही क्लियर कट रीजनिंग होता है, और जिन चीजों में हमारे एपिक्स में जहां पे शेड्स ऑफ ग्रे है वहां भी हम लोग ब्लैक्स और व्हाइट ढूंढ लेते हैं, हम ग्रे को अलग कर लेते हैं। कमिंग टू माय फेवरेट एग्जांपल, द महाभारत। महाभारत जहां तक मैंने जितनी चीजें पढ़ी है, देखी है, इट इज अ सुपर्ब स्टडी ऑफ मैन्स इंटरनल स्ट्रगल अबाउट हिज ड्यूटी, अबाउट हिज राइट्स, अबाउट हिज रॉन्ग्स, अबाउट एक्सप्लोरिंग व्हाट इज डिजायर, अबाउट एक्सप्लोरिंग व्हाट इज ड्यूटी, अबाउट एक्सप्लोरिंग व्हाट इज एम्बिशन, अबाउट एक्सप्लोरिंग व्हाट इज धर्म, कहां पर मेरा डिजायर खत्म होता है और मेरा धर्म शुरू होता है, क्या होगा अगर मेरा धर्म और मेरा एम्बिशन दोनों मुझे एक ही ओर लेके जा रहे हैं, मुझे कैसे पता चलेगा कि ये कहां तक मेरा स्वार्थ है और कहां तक मेरा धर्म है। और हर तरफ अगर आप देखने जाओगे, अगर आप ठीक से देखते जाओगे, हर तरफ आपको कहीं पर हर चीज का एक अलग देखने का नजरिया मिलेगा। कहां से शुरुआत हुई महाभारत की, कौन पहले गलत था, किसने पहले एक गलत काम किया, किसने पहले, किसका स्वार्थ पहले गलत था, क्या धृतराष्ट्र गलत है कि अंधे होते हुए भी वो राजा बनना चाहते थे, क्या ये गलत था कि उन पांडु को राजा बनना पड़ा क्योंकि उनकी आंखें नहीं थी, और उसके बाद जब उन्हें राजा बनाया गया और वो बड़े बेटे थे तो क्या ये गलत था कि वो अपने बेटे को राजा देखना चाहते थे, क्या युधिष्ठिर गलत है कि वो एक अच्छे राजा साबित होना चाहते थे। ये सब कुछ ग्रेज में चलता है, लेकिन हमने उसे इतना सिंप्लीफाई कर दिया है कि शकुनी की एंट्री होते ही एक विलेनस म्यूजिक शुरू हो जाता है। और ये नाम दुर्योधन दुशासन क्या मतलब है इनके, और कौन मां अपने बेटे का नाम दुर्योधन और दुशासन रखेगी? कब, अगर आप सोचो, विदाउट अ डाउट वो नाम, अगर वाकई अगर वो नाम थे किसी के, तो उस मां ने उनके नाम सुर्योधन और सुशासन रखे होंगे। कब इसे सिंप्लीफाई करते करते गांव में कथा सुनाते सुनाते ये कैसे दुर्योधन और दुशासन हो गए, ताकि बस दुर्योधन खत्म। क्या सोचने की जरूरत है कि बुरा कौन है, विलेन कौन है, साफ नाम में ही है दुर्योधन दुशासन। साइड्स हमने बना लिए हैं, अब कहानी कहना आसान है और हर बच्चे को ब्लैक और व्हाइट आसानी से समझाया जा सकता है उस कहानी का सारा लेकर जो अल्टीमेट एपिक है ग्रेज को लेकर। रामायण के बारे में तो बात करने को डर लगता है, इतना सेक्रेट हो चुका है कि अब ये एक्सप्लोर करना कि उसमें शायद कोई ग्रेज है, स्पेशली स्टैंडिंग हियर एज अ मुस्लिम, मेक्स मी नर्वस। बट द फैक्ट ऑफ द मैटर इज, क्या सब कुछ इतना क्लियर कट था? रावण अपने कल्चर में उतनी ही श्रद्धा से और उतने ही रिस्पेक्ट से ब्रह्म राक्षस माने जाते थे, और राक्षस ऑटोमेटिकली तो बुरे कभी थे ही नहीं हमारे कल्चर में। कब इतना ऑब्वियस हो गया कि राक्षस बुरे हैं? वो एक अलग स्पीशीज थी जिनके अपने मोटिवेशन थे, उनमें अपनी एक सिद्धि होती थी, उनमें अपने कॉन्फ्लिक्ट चलते थे, उनमें अपने अच्छे बुरे होते थे। कब इतना ऑब्वियस हो गया कि वो इतना बुरा था? क्या करता वो अगर उसे लगता है कि उसकी बहन का इंसल्ट हुआ है? और जब उन्होंने सीता को, अगर उन्होंने अगवा किया तो उन्होंने उनको कैसे रखा, अपनी बीवी को सीता की दासी बना के रखा? क्या हम एज राइटर्स ये एक्सप्लोर भी करते हैं? नहीं, क्योंकि हमारी ट्रेडिशन में नहीं है। अब इस कल्चर से आते हुए, इस ट्रेडिशन से आते हुए हमारी आदत हो गई है कि सब कुछ एक्सटर्नल है, बुराई है वो बाहर, जो सफेद हूं वो मैं। आपको एसोसिएशन क्रिएट करना है वाइट के साथ ताकि ऑडियंस आपके साथ रहे बच्चों की तरह, एट द एंड ऑफ द डे ब्लैक हार जाए और अब एक मॉरल निकल आएगा। हमें आदत ही नहीं है, अंदर झांके हमारे अंदर ही ब्लैक और वाइट दोनों को ढूंढने में, हमारे अंदर के ग्रेस को ढूंढने में और उस कॉन्फ्लिक्ट को एक्सटर्नलाइज करने में। अगर हम सोच भी ले एक कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, अब सोचिए क्या क्या होता है। पहले तो आपने सोचा कि चलो अंदर ये दुविधा चल रही है एक इंसान के और ये एक कॉन्फ्लिक्ट है। अब पहले आपको एक प्रोड्यूसर को समझाना है, तो पहले तो आपने किसी तरह अपने अंदर ये कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढ के निकाला, अब आपको एक प्रोड्यूसर को वो अंदरूनी कॉन्फ्लिक्ट समझाना है। अनफॉर्चुनेटली प्रोड्यूसर आपसे पूरा सुनने के बाद कहेगा, यार बहुत कमाल है, मुझे बस रेफरेंस दो ये किस फिल्म से मिलता जुलता है, मुझे बस, मैं ये नहीं कह रहा हूं डीवीडी कॉपी करो, मुझे बस देखना है कि क्या रेफरेंस है। दे हैवंट सीन इट, इट्स नॉट देयर फॉल्ट, उन्होंने देखा नहीं है, वो लोग नहीं इमेजिन कर पाएंगे। कहां देखेंगे वो लोग? वही देखेंगे जहां पे ये हो रहा है, और अनफॉर्चुनेटली ये वेस्टर्न फिल्म्स के अंदर ज्यादा हुआ है, बहुत पहले से होता आ रहा है, हमने नहीं किया है, कैसे नजर आएगा उनको? और अगर कोई स्टार को एक इंटरेस्टिंग रोल उसमें मिल गया, फिर प्रोड्यूसर को सब कुछ नजर आ जाएगा साफ, पर उन्हें कुछ नहीं नजर आ रहा है, उन्हें सिर्फ फ्राइडे के कलेक्शन नजर आ रहे हैं। पर शुरुआत हमें करनी है कि उसे एक्सेल, और हमारा क्राफ्ट कहां पर है? ना हमने स्टडी किया है, ना हमें आदत है, और यह मैं एक एक्यूजेशन की तरह नहीं कह रहा हूं, मैं एक एक्सप्लोरेशन की तरह कह रहा हूं कि हम सब सोचे इस बारे में कि कहां से आएगी आदत, कहां से आएगा ये कॉन्फ्लिक्ट क्रिएट करने का नया, आप इसे तर्क कह लीजिए, आप इसे टेक्निक कह लीजिए, आप इसे टोटका कह लीजिए, कुछ भी, क्यों वही करना है हमें, कहां से आएगा? क्या स्टडी करते हैं हम, कितना झांकते हैं अपने अंदर? क्या हम भी उतने ही लेजी हो गए कि जब प्रोड्यूसर को डीवीडी दिखाना है तो हम भी डीवीडी से ही शुरुआत कर लेते? अगर कास्टिंग से ही अगर प्रोसेस शुरू होना है तो फिर बाकी सब छोड़ो, पहले एक इंटरेस्टिंग रोल लिखो जो एक बड़े स्टार को पसंद आए। क्या नहीं किया है अक्षय कुमार ने काफी टाइम से? सैफ का स्टेट ऑफ माइंड अभी क्या चल रहा है, क्या करना चाहता है वो? आमिर ने बहुत टाइम से क्या नहीं किया है? हमारा भी यही चल रहा है, अगर हम ऑनेस्टली देखें तो हम भी वही सोच रहे हैं, और क्योंकि हम जानते हैं कि हम ऑनेस्ट काम नहीं कर रहे, क्योंकि हम जानते हैं कि ज्यादातर काम नहीं चल रहा है, 80-85% फिल्में फ्लॉप हो रही है, हम अपने आप को पैडिंग करते हैं, एक साथ में चार फिल्में करेंगे, एक तो चली जाएगी, तो इसके बजाय कि चलो अब स्टार मिल गया, प्रोड्यूसर मिल गया, अब लगे रहो यार, ढूंढ के निकालो, खोद के निकालो, कहानी को खोद के निकालो, चलो शुरू हो गया कहीं से भी, लेकिन अब खोदते रहो, कुछ ना कुछ निकलता जाएगा। लेकिन नहीं, आपको तो बस ये डर है कि अब चलेगी नहीं चलेगी पता नहीं, कुछ हो गया है, प्रोजेक्ट जुड़ रहा है, चार कर लो, पैसा तो आप कमा लोगे। कितने लोग यहां पर ना कहना जानते हैं, कितने लोगों में ना कहने की हिम्मत है? और अगर आप में वो हिम्मत नहीं है तो कोई भी एसोसिएशन या यूनियन बनाकर आप में वो ना कहने की हिम्मत नहीं आएगी। फर्क सिर्फ इतना होगा कि आप हाँ कहने के नए तरीके ढूंढ लेंगे और उस यूनियन को इस्तेमाल करेंगे ताकि आपको ना कहना पड़े, लेकिन आपका काम बनता रहे। सो फर्स्ट वी हैव टू लुक विद इन आवरसेल्व्स कि क्या जरूरी है। लेट्स फेस अप टू इट कि डिफॉल्ट स्टोरी लाइन नहीं रही, आपको अब सोचना पड़ेगा। और अगर आप बाहर के कल्चर से जब तक आप स्टोरी ट्रांसपोज करने की कोशिश करते रहेंगे वो नहीं होगा, वो हमारा एक्सपीरियंस नहीं है। कहीं हमें अपने एक्सपीरियंस ने, अपने रिश्तों में हमें वो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढना पड़ेगा और हमें हमारे टेक्निक को सुधारना पड़ेगा। जैसे अभी कुछ देर पहले अंजुम ने कहा कि स्क्रीन प्ले राइटर का क्रेडिट नहीं होता था। डायलॉग्स आर एवरीथिंग इन हिंदी फिल्म्स। डायलॉग बाजी यानी बस और क्या मंगता क्या है, हो गया फिल्म बन गई। लेकिन डायलॉग तभी मुमकिन है जब सामने विलन खड़ा हो। डायलॉग तभी मुमकिन है जब माँ बाप कह रहे हैं कि नहीं आप शादी नहीं कर सकते। डायलॉग तब पॉसिबल है जब कॉन्फ्लिक्ट आपके बाहर है। अब जैसे ही आप ये इंटरनल ग्रेज में और एक छोटी छोटी चीजों में अगर आप कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ढूंढ रहे हैं और अब उस कॉन्फ्लिक्ट को एक्सटर्नलाइज करना है, यू आर लॉस्ट। क्या कहोगे डायलॉग में? मुझे अपने आप पर डाउट है, मैं ये सोच रहा हूं। द प्रॉब्लम इज दैट मोर देन एवर वी कैन नो लॉन्गर इग्नोर द क्राफ्ट ऑफ स्क्रीन प्ले। कितनी सारी चीजें हैं जो आपको मदद कर सकती है अपने थॉट्स को, अपने स्टोरी को, अपने कॉन्फ्लिक्ट को, अपने कैरेक्टर्स को एक्सटर्नलाइज करने में, उनको दर्शाने में। मैं जिंदगी में दो लोगों को गुरु मानता था जब मैंने लिखना शुरू किया। एक है रवि ओझा, एक है शिवम नायर। रवि ओझा से मैंने एक बात सीखी, सिनेमा स्ट्रक्चर इट स्ट्रक्चर इट स्ट्रक्चर। शिवम नायर से एक बात सीखी कि डायलॉग का इस्तेमाल तब करो जब अपनी कहानी कहने के और सारे तरीके खत्म हो जाए, सारे तरीके खत्म हो जाए। अजीब बात यह है कि मेरी पहचान काफी हद तक ऐसे डायलॉग राइटर रही है, लेकिन शायद इसलिए नहीं कि मैं डायलॉग बाजी अच्छी कर पाता हूं, शायद इसलिए कि मैं डायलॉग्स को स्क्रीन प्ले से अलग नहीं देख पाता। राजू आपके सामने है, शायद वो आपसे कहेंगे कि जब मुन्ना भाई के स्क्रीन प्ले पे मैंने उनके साथ कहा था कि उन्होंने मुझे कहा कि डायलॉग करो, मैंने कहा राजू मैं सिर्फ डायलॉग नहीं कर पाऊंगा, मुझे कुछ चीजें उसके हिसाब से बदलनी पड़ेगी। एंड लकीली आई वाज विद द डायरेक्टर जिन्होंने कहा और डायलॉग कैसे होता है। बट मोस्ट ऑफ अस वो जो स्क्रीन प्ले लिखा गया है उसे एक अलग डॉक्यूमेंट बनाते हैं और एक अलग सेट ऑफ डायलॉग्स लिख लेते हैं। वो कैसे मिलेंगे, क्या हो गए, क्या सोचा हुआ है, कौन सी चीज कहना जरूरी है, कौन सी चीज कहना जरूरी नहीं है, कौन सी चीज बस एक लुक से, एक कट से, एक आवाज से। अगर किसी का गुस्सा आपको दिखाना है, सबसे बोरियत वाला तरीका है जब वो इंसान स्क्रीन पर कहे मैं गुस्से में हूं। इससे बुरा तरीका नहीं हो सकता है। उससे थोड़ा कम बुरा तरीका है जब कोई और उसके बारे में कहे वो बहुत गुस्से में है। मजा तब है, और ये आज मैं आपसे जहां तक मैं समझता हूं एक गोल्डन टिप दे रहा हूं, गोल्डन टिप कि व्हाट द होल थिंग इज अबाउट। मजा तब है जब किसी भी कैरेक्टर के बारे में, किसी भी सिचुएशन के बारे में जो बात आप कहना चाहते हैं वो बहुत आइडियलिस्टिक है, वो बहुत गुस्से वाला है, ये उससे नफरत करता है, वो उसका खून करने वाला है, जो भी आप कहना चाहते हैं, ये बात बिना किसी के लफ्जों में कहे, अगर ये बात इन लफ्जों में अगर आप ऑडियंस के दिमाग में उन्हें जन्म दे सकते हैं, अगर किसी के ना कहते हुए अगर वो इंसान बस मुस्कुरा रहा है और किसी और को लग रहा है कि नहीं वो तो बहुत खुश है, सब कुछ चल रहा है, और कुछ हुआ और ऑडियंस कहता रहे नहीं है तो बहुत गुस्से में है। ये हुआ सिनेमा। ऑडियंस ने एक ऐसी चीज जानी, परखी, सोची जो आपने कही नहीं, मतलब ऑडियंस अब एंगेज हो गई है। और जब तक ऑडियंस एंगेज नहीं होगी आप ऑडियंस को मैनिपुलेट नहीं कर सकते। एंड स्क्रीन प्ले इज नथिंग एक्सेप्ट मैनिपुलेटिंग द ऑडियंस। पर ये क्राफ्ट हमें याद करना पड़ेगा, सीखना पड़ेगा। प्लीज ये ना सोचे कि अब हमसे जितना होता था अब तो हमारी आदत हो गई, अब हम ऐसे ही करते, अब हमें प्रोटेक्ट किया जाए, हम साथ में मिलेंगे तो ये चल जाएगा, चल जाएगा। और शायद आपके साथ थोड़ी कम बदतमीजी होगी, शायद कम ह्यूमिलिएशन होगा, शायद ज्यादा पैसा मिलेगा, लेकिन कुछ बदलेगा नहीं। दे विल जस्ट फाइंड अल्टीमेटली द पीपल विद मोर मनी विल कीप कॉलिंग द शॉट्स अनलेस दे एक्नॉलेज यू एज मोर ब्रिलियंट देन देम। हर कोई एक राइटर से क्यों कह सकता है कि राइटिंग कैसे करे? एक एडिटर के साथ बैठ के हम लोग नहीं कहते ना कि यार ये ऐसे कर लो वैसे कर लो, और कहते भी तो एक दो सजेशन देके छोड़ देंगे। एक म्यूजिक डायरेक्टर को ये नहीं पता ये की नहीं ये की वजह क्यों, अपने काम के बारे में आपसे ज्यादा जानते हैं, मुंह नहीं खुलता आपका, बेवकूफ लगेंगे आप। क्यों राइटर से कहना इतना आसान है? सिर्फ इसलिए नहीं कि हर कोई कहानी कह सकता है, नहीं, क्योंकि जिस तरह हम कहानी कहते हैं हर कोई कहानी कह सकता है। सो प्लीज टू थिंग्स नीड टू बी डन। यस वी नीड टू बी प्रोटेक्टेड, यस मॉडल कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स नीड टू बी ड्रॉन अप, यस रेम्यूनरेशन नीड्स टू बी फेयर, यस आवर राइट्स नीड टू बी प्रोटेक्टेड, यस वी नीड टू बी गिवन द स्पेस टू एक्सप्लोर आवर क्रिएटिविटी। लेकिन ये एक क्रच ना बन जाए जिसकी वजह से हम कुछ ना करें, कुछ ना बदले, कुछ ना सीखे। विथ ऑल ड्यू रिस्पेक्ट, इंडियन स्क्रिप्ट राइटिंग हैज फार 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 फ्रॉम अराइव्ड, ओके, बट वी हैव अराइव्ड हियर, इट इज अ स्टार्ट। प्लीज लेट अस नॉट कंफ्यूज व्हाट इट्स अबाउट, इट्स नॉट जस्ट अबाउट कमिंग टुगेदर एंड फॉर्मिंग यूनियंस, इट इज कमिंग टुगेदर एंड बिकमिंग बेटर राइटर्स। थैंक यू।
That was a very interesting take on this. No villains, whether a cause of concern or celebration, I don't know. No villains in a society. But what was interesting is ki yes, conflict dhoondna padega, kuch naye conflict dhoondne padenge. Because there's 100 years of cinema which has happened and everything has been tried and done before. So we would have to find some newer conflicts. Couple of things Abbas said were very interesting. He said producers want to see what they've always seen, which is understandable, which is okay, they are not creative people, so that's what, so we'll have to find ways to explain it to them. I know they always, I've always encountered this also with people, they feel ki ye chala hai to ye safe hai, hum isi ko banate hain, but what people don't realize ki wo chala tha kyunki wo us waqt unique tha, aur wo second time unique nahi hai, isliye wo sabse unsafe hai. So I don't think we should tread on that path. Attempt should be to probably look for unique things and improve our technique is something very interesting. He said we have to make an effort to improve our technique. Now I would invite Abhijat Joshi to come and talk to us.
Well, first of all, I'm really glad to be here and to have heard Abbas. And as he was speaking, I was remembering with what passion and with what conviction he works. And I was actually reminded of something that he had said about conflict. And he had said that while kind of, we had worked for a month together on a script, which I'm very glad that was never made. But we were attempting to work on a screenplay, and he was actually knocking down an idea that I'd come up with. And while knocking down that idea, he had said something which has stuck with me. And he had said that, I said that, you know, this guy is doing this because he needs to do this, or because he's getting this out of it, and he's also getting this out of it. And Abbas, I clearly remember you're saying that boss, isme do conflict hai yaar. And two conflicts are always weaker than one conflict. Do you remember that? And when he said that, this was a fascinating thing, which I have always carried. I learned from that. And I've tried to implement that, that it's weaker drama when there are two kinds of motivations. Now the thing that I'm going to talk about is, what are the areas, what are the forums where we hear these kinds of things? I feel like a bastard. I feel that I'm a bastard of screenwriting because I have no sense of tradition. I have no idea who my father is in the realms of Indian screenwriting. क्योंकि ये जो बातें हैं जो राइटर्स के मन में भरी पड़ी है और बहुत सॉलिड कन्विक्शन के साथ ये राइटर्स ये बातें कह सकते हैं, ये उनके टूल्स ऑफ द ट्रेड हैं. दीज आर द टूल्स ऑफ द ट्रेड, दिस इज आवर क्राफ्ट. एंड वी अराइव एट दिस दिस लेवल ऑफ क्राफ्ट आफ्टर इयर्स ऑफ प्रिपरेशन. बट टेल मी वन फोरम और वन मैगजीन, वन बुक where I can read that book, I can open the pages, and I would know what Abbas thinks of screenwriting. Where I would know what Gurudat Saab had in mind when he put in something like Jinne Naaz Hai Hind Par Wo Kahan Hai. How did that poetry of Sahir come in the form of a song in Pyasa? I would love to know this. And fortunately, there have been a few books on Gurudat Saab. But there are so many fascinating things which we have absolutely no clue about. I was talking to Sridhar outside, and we are talking about our favorite writers from the West. And I know how Billy Wilder wrote his screenplays. Because there's a book of conversations. I almost know by heart how Hitchcock wrote his screenplays, right? There's this fantastic book with Truffaut, where he, goes in great detail about the craft of screenwriting, the famous concept of suspense versus surprise, which every screenwriter now knows. But our own examples, our own myths, our own legends have been completely neglected, and that's why I feel like a bastard. पता ही नहीं है यार कि अपने जो बाप लोग थे, जो इतने बड़े-बड़े लोग थे, वो कैसे लिखते थे? मैं एक बार Atul had taken me to Gulzar Saab's place. Atul, you remember that? We were walking outside his house, and Atul said, "We'll go in," and we barged in, and Gulzar Saab was irritated, but he quickly offered us tea. And he wanted to get rid of us, you know. But I had these few minutes with him where I wanted to ask him something, which I wanted to ask him for a long time, and this was my opportunity. There's a line in the film Anand, which goes like this: "Babu Moshai, jab tak zinda ho, tab tak mara nahi. Jab mar gaya, to sala main hi nahi." Now, what I wanted to ask Gulzar Saab was that, was the use of the word sala conscious, right? Because if you use that line, "Babu Moshai, jab tak zinda ho, tab tak mara nahi. Jab mar gaya, to main hi nahi." To maza nahi aata. It's like a platitude, right? But "jab tak zinda ho, tab tak mara nahi. Jab mar gaya, to sala main hi nahi." To usme wo kamal ka ek dialogue ho jata hai. Now, was this conscious? Did he arrive at this decision? Or did it just flow out of his pen? How did this happen? It can be a stupid question, but our own masters, their craft of writing, I would love to know more about. And on the same day, he narrated a fascinating story that when he was writing Anand, he said Hrishikesh Mukherjee had given him a very clear instruction that in the very first scene of the film, you should know that Anand is going to die in the film. Because Mr. Hrishikesh Mukherjee didn't want the audience to hang in that kind of a suspense. That is this guy going to be saved or is he going to die? That is not the film. The film is how this man confronts his destiny, which is unavoidable. Now, when you think of something like this, you feel that as a screenwriter, you have a little secret in your hand, right? And scientists share their secrets. When new knowledge comes in the area of science, it gets published in a journal, right? And all leading scientists of the world have an access to that. Otherwise, that science cannot progress, right? Whereas we hardly ever talk about our experiences, about how we develop our craft, I've had the privilege to write two films now with Raju. And actually, you know, this says, has the Indian script arrived? And as we were driving in, I was with Raju and I told him that, boss, it has arrived through these doors, you know, because Raju, I think, is a great writer. It's an absolute privilege to work with him. But for the last 4 years, we have been communicating almost every day. I cannot recall a whole week in the last 4 years when we have not talked extensively, except when he's shooting. And there are so many such little craft-related things which become available to us, and we suddenly realize that, wow, this is the aha moment. This is the wow moment. Jaise lage raha hu main, I was in the US, and Raju was writing in a hotel on the mud island, and we were talking on the phone. And there is a scene where Munna is addressing the old people, and he says that, yaar, kisi ne Gandhi ka putla patthar maar ke, ek naujawan ne uske upar patthar maar diya. Now, we were trying to write this scene, and at one moment, we realized that from behind, Bapu is going to tell him that the answer is very simple. Destroy all the statues in the country. And we suddenly realized that we had hit upon something which was like a formula. I hate to use that word. Please don't get me wrong. I'm not talking about formula films. Every film, I believe, has a kind of a DNA. And when we got that, we found that we had unraveled the DNA structure of Lagero. Didn't realize that. But then consciously we used it so often that every time Munna is confronted with a problem, Gandhiji is going to tell him something which is the ulta, right? So when Jimmy Shergill calls and says that he cannot have 7 lakh rupees, he doesn't have 7 lakh rupees, so Bapu says, it's simple. And then you're listening. That, what, excuse me, what do you mean it's simple? It's not simple. But we had realized that if we do this, if we play the opposite, the scenes were kind of bursting into life. And we kept on doing this relentlessly. In many scenes we have done this. When Janvi, for instance, comes at the end and she confronts Munna, she says, "Tumne mujhse jhoot kyon kaha? Why did you say you're not a professor? You're the best professor I've ever seen." Right? So relentlessly we have done that. The new film that we have been writing, we tried that technique. It didn't work. Because I think, as I said, every film has a different DNA. And we have to discover that. In this film, to our astonishment, we have realized that objects, whenever we bring in an object into the texture of the scene is coming to life. So we have hundreds of objects, including a pen, and sub. Raj will kill me if I reveal
many of that.
But there are so many objects. Now, this is something which I would love to share with this fraternity, right? And also not just the success things, the failures. You know, I had written a film which was horrible, you know? And I have learned so much from that film. And without that, Raju will, I think, agree that we would have struggled with Lagero. Because I was constantly reminding Raju that I have done this and it was a disaster. Let's steer clear of that. And so examples of our failures, because we learn from our failures. And we are finally, we believe firmly that there's no such thing as failures. Failures can only be of intentions. If you intend to write a good screenplay, you're already successful. Hell with the worldly success or the failure of this screenplay. But our own experiences, whether good or bad, they need to be documented and they need to be made available. Our previous generation, with due respect, I have to say, has failed to do this. And that's why today I feel like a bastard. I have no clue as to how some of the most brilliant ideas came into existence. You know, the wo jo vidya hai, that has been lost. A lot of that knowledge has been lost. I have no clue. What was the moment when, you know, they decided that Thakur will not have arms or he cannot pick up the guns because he has no arms in Chole? And that's the interval point. It's a killer. And how did that happen? I would love to know this. And we live in a world where William Goldman, Charlie Chaplin, Preston Sturges, Billy Wilder, Fellini, Bergman, how they wrote their screenplays, we know. And a lot of those things we have imbibed in our own craft. And our own screenplays, the masterpieces, how they came into existence, how, what was the process, how long it took, what were the struggles, what were the big obstacles, how they were overcome. We do not have, these examples are never quoted, these legends are not spread. You know, they're anecdotal things, which are amusing, they're fun. Anecdotes are always fun. But anecdotes do not give you great knowledge. There's difference between tools of knowledge, tools that empower you as writers, and merely anecdotal things. And right now, I see the trend is of just merely running after anecdotes, you know, spicy stories. Whereas my appeal to a forum like this would be, let's not repeat the mistake that our previous generation has made. Whatever the worth of our writing, good or bad, but let's have a dialogue about it within the fraternity. Let's have journals where these things are documented. Let's have the ambition, the books are published, which carry this process that Abbas has been talking about. It should not be a situation that what Abbas thinks, for to know that I have to come here, right? It should be available, widely available on the internet, in books, in journals. And Raju, let's start here, something like that. I think I'll end on that note.
That was well said. That's true that unlike other subjects, you take physics, chemistry, it's a defined science. You know, you mix two chemicals, this is what you're going to get. But script writing is not like that. It is different every time. As Abbas, as Abhijat said, the DNA structure is different every time. So probably we need to learn from each other's experiences. We need to share. Gyan batna mangta hai, as they say. And I think we should, there are a lot of aspiring writers here. I think there should be an effort to meet up with people who've written great stuff and try and document whatever they've written. There should be a serious effort to do this. I would now like to invite S.M. Vasant to talk to us.
Good evening. Friends, I am dividing my talk into three parts. Each part will be preceded by a question by Film Writers Association and my feelings about the same. The three parts, though seemingly unconnected, are actually hyperlinked with the issues in one cascading into the another. The use of the word hyperlink is significant, as will be obvious when I reach the third question. I'd like to take this as the first question. At an individual level, how do I struggle with my urge for excellence pitted against fears of my own creative limitations? Some people go to movie to watch their favorite hero in action. Some go for the song and dance. Some go to pass their time. And there are multiple other reasons why people go to movies. What is my experience of cinema as a viewer? Why do I go to a film? I go to a movie to watch and experience the story it's portraying. Even from an young age, I have liked movies which are short on entertainment and content, short on entertainment content, but rich in story content. As I grew up, a different story alone did not suffice. I wanted the story to be told in a realistic manner. I wanted the characters in the cinema to be at ease and speak like the way I saw and heard people around me. high-strung acting alienated me. From a mere viewer of a cinema, I became a participant in the making of a film. First as an assistant director, slowly moving to become a director. I worked under K. Balachandar for 18 films in 8 years. When I became a director, writer of cinema, I tried to practice what I enjoyed as a viewer. Will the people like my film? Will the mass audience be entertained by a particular scene? Will my story suit the image of a particular actor? I never bothered with these questions, like the above questions, while writing the screenplay of my films. But I was immensely bothered with questions like, are the scenes in my film organic to the story I'm trying to tell? Do the scenes have the pinch of reality about them? Herein lies my cross. Over a period of time, the opposite of what I aspire to do has become a trend. Pack a lot of entertainment with a few sequences for a story. My last film, Satam Podade, that was my 10th film, dealt with extreme bad habit of a man, which leads him to a deficiency in a vital physiological function, which in turn degenerates to neurosis, resulting in an innocent woman becoming a victim. The victimized woman unentangles from her woes with the help of a good soul, only to be stalked again by the same tormentor. I had dealt with the universal issue of how an unreconciled physiological disorder can detonate ruthless violence and the exemplary courage of a woman who faced the onslaught. Though the film had a decent run, with excellent reviews, many considered the film heavy. This is surprising since I was never a top heavy filmmaker. I was nurtured in meaningful mainstream cinema. I had been making movies for the last several years, to be precise, 18 years. And the destiny of my story content have always remained constant. But suddenly my film became heavy, while several of my films in the past were not considered heavy. I think this is a pointer to the times we are living. I think attention spans and tolerance limits are shrinking. Will they make me struggle? Will they impose creative limitations? These are some of my fears at an individual level. The second question I'd like to take is that it's true that recent years have thrown up some striking screenplays in all kinds of genres, ranging from romantic comedies to political thrillers to some good drama, especially in Hindi cinema. However, given that these examples are truly few and far in between, do we have any initiatives planned to at least address this lacuna and help younger, newer writers? I think one needs to address this lacuna and plan initiatives to help younger, newer writers. This is definitely a multifaceted problem, and I will address one facet of it. My address will largely concern with the content and theme rather than the craft. There are different types of cinema like feature films, fiction, non-fiction, docus, art films, educational films, etc. And these various types of cinema can be made in variety of ways like narrative, non-narrative, experimental. Here I am confining myself to the fiction, feature film rendered as narrative mainstream cinema. I feel the prime question a writer, a filmmaker should address is whether communion will happen between the film he is writing and the viewer. Communion between the filmmaker and the filmgoer happens only when there is a common ground. I feel there had been only one major common ground portrayed in Indian cinema, which is folk drama and tales and epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata, which included macro-level wars and micro-level family disputes. Needless to say that, as everybody knows, cinema in India, by and large, has its origin in the folk drama and the epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata. The tales and the epics are embedded in our subconscious. Among a variety of thematic content, the themes of good versus bad, with good winning over bad and justice prevailing, has been the most exploited by filmmakers. In the same vein is the institution of family. The father is understood to be the breadwinner and mother to be caretaker of the house. This knowledge of the viewer is used as a ground by the writer to weave a film. The typical householder is God-fearing, wants to love and be loved. wanting mainly a chance at a decent job, an opportunity for their children to have an education and a better life than they had. In short, these are great archetypes of Indian cinema. So what is the problem? The problems are what I would term as the shallow use of current events. For example, you know, Taj Hotel terrorist attack comes. So everybody will go for that. That's what I call it as shallow use of current events. Let us look at the theme of a good versus bad with good winning over bad. This theme is being played and replayed still in different garbs. The garbs keeps changing according to the forces of current events. Rama clad in dhoti, armed with bow and arrow with Sita as lover and wife, transforms into MGR, Rajinikanth or Sunny Deol. Clad in a police officer uniform, armed with an automatic pistol with a heroine or a lover. The villain transforms from King Ravana to Zamindar, corrupt politician, or he can be an unauthorized human cloners, degenerated biotechnologist or computer hackers to ISA agents for the neighboring country backed terrorist. See, the presence of history are allowed only at the outer level. This is the point I would like to really make it. The presence of history are allowed only at the outer level. The impact of history on the mind of the hero and villain are never dealt with. This is what I refer as the shallow use of current events. The outcome of this, which is gaining strength, especially in the cinema of South India, is as follows. While stereotypes are maintained in all its glory, they are suppressed by the overwhelming superficial details of current events, accompanied by technical gloss and rich craft. This garb begins to supersede and gloss over the inherent and mostly harmless stereotypical theme of the film. A feeling of analyzing contemporary issue is cheated, as if history and modernity has been taken into account. Somewhere the audience is tricked into forgetting that the word of flower is not the real flower. The very mention of the word Pakistan becomes synonymous with sinister. Today, many of the so-called important popular films, especially in the South, are being crafted using a dangerous cocktail of both fact and fantasy, which confuses the mass audience. Along with the above is the lack of vulnerability and inhumanity of certain action heroes, which is so disgusting. Actually, the heroes themselves are not disgusting, but their popularity depresses me. Their popularity says our society somewhere needs them. We need champions, larger than life models, since we don't believe in ourselves. These superheroes never face the agonizing choices a common man goes through. Their choices are generally to choose between a few sets of one-liners, which the audience are programmed to clap. Cinema can be superficial, but not inane with lack of real drama. For me, then, the problem of the contemporary screenwriter are: A, is it possible to tell a compelling story with a fresh common ground, rooted in the history, rather than the simplistic reduction of folk drama and epics to deal with good versus bad? B, can temporary Indian mainstream cinema invent a cinematic narrative that can carry contemporary themes without hiding it beneath romance, spectacle, melodrama, and the shallow use of current events? I'd like to add that there have been new voices, especially in Hindi cinema, which dramatized the disparity between the establishment view of the country and the view of the common man on men and events. For example, there has been a spate of films that have attempted to address the themes of youth, disillusion, and rebellion, a new common ground. I'd like to place on record that I really liked Sudhir Mishra's film. I don't want to take a chance of pronouncing that film with Naxalite Turbulence as its backdrop, and Maniratnam's Yuva, and charting a mass-based mobilization, but not through uprising, but within the parliamentary democracy, and Govind Nihalani's Dev and Khalid Mohammed's Fisa, which explored from different points of view that stigmatization which pushes Muslims towards militancy, and the recent Wednesday. They are valiant attempts. Hope they become movement. My third question will be, are we lagging behind in evolving and developing modern screenplay structuring, which seems to be the need of the hour? Anthony Giddens, a former director of the London School of Economics, defined globalization, I quote, as the intensification of worldwide social relations, which link distant localities in such a way that local happenings are shaped by events occurring many miles away, and vice versa. I unquote. Interconnections and interdependence have become catchwords post-globalization. How has this affected screenplay structuring? I think it has affected screenplay structuring by giving birth to hyperlink movies. Hyperlink movies are defined as films following multiple storylines and multiple characters. These storylines and characters are intersect, and events in one storyline affect the other storylines or characters, often in ways that the characters are unaware of or do not fully understand. Hyperlink cinema is often characterized by globe-spanning locations, multiple languages, multiple characters, strict parameters in the art direction and cinematography, and the frequent and drastic use of flashback and flash-forward. So narrative is used in each storyline to create an abrupt visual break when cutting between characters and storylines. Janet Grisha, in her essay explaining the concept of hyperlink cinema, writes, films of the genre called hyperlink cinema don't have hyperlinks, and they don't have to be online. They have multiple storylines and characters that miss each other or collide. Storylines intersect and entwine. The idea is to reproduce on film the mess, the confusion, and the richness of modern life. The overriding theme of the hyperlink cinema is connection, or rather interconnection. The famous films classified under hyperlink cinemas, as we all know, Traffic, Crash, or Nine Lives, or Babel, or Amorosporos, 21 Grams, Siriana, we can go on with the list. One director who has made several films in the same genre is my favorite, Alexandre Iñárritu. So I have spoken about hyperlink cinema only to highlight that modern screenplay structuring is evolving into uncharted territories. Hyperlink cinema is one facet of modern screenplay structuring. There must be other types which embodies in its structure the very contours of reality. This type of cinema is certainly being attempted here. As usual, they are far and few. Hope they become a movement. Thanks for calling.
Thanks, Vasanth. I think Vasanth tried to encompass a lot of issues in his speech. I just jotted down a couple of them, which says stories should have a fresh perspective, which is what Abbas also emphasized in a way. We don't need to hide our themes under conventional romance and action films. And what was interesting was hyperlink cinema. This is a new term I learned, and I think it's very fascinating that Abbas was talking about the same thing, that what there are no conflicts, then how? So this is another way of scripting in a way. I think now we should...
Raju, before you go on, there's something with regard to Vasanth's talk that I want to just kind of make sure is underlined. I just felt it was important, and with your permission. So you referred to the three questions that you never ask very early in your talk, the three questions about your film that you don't ask, and then you said the questions that you do ask. Can I request you to just repeat those questions? And I really want each one of you to think about two things. One, how often we are asked these very questions, and how often we don't even need to be prompted. These are the very questions we automatically ask ourselves. And these are the very questions that he referred to as, I'd never ask these questions. Please honestly explore, do you start out with this set of questions when you start your screenplay or your film?
You feel really embarrassed. I think it's all basic thing one has to do, but anyway. Otherwise, we can't call ourselves as writers. Anyway, having asked, let me say this. Will the people like my film? Will the mass audience be entertained by a particular scene? Will my story suit the image of a particular actor? I never bothered with these questions like the above while writing the screenplays of my films.
Thank you, sir.
So I think we'll begin with a question answer session. I think you had started something, so you can address that to Abbas, and we can begin there.
What happened?
People want to know a little more about the hyperlink.
I think the topic is hyped a little bit more. No, it's only, I think, one or two Hindi films have also come. I think if I'm right, Metro, no?
Metro.
Yeah, yeah. Metro is done. And I think a lot of people would have seen, yeah, Yuva. And I think the people who are interested in, I suggested the names. I think Harian is the right person to say more about that. I think a lot of films have come now in the West. I think Babel is the ultimate, I say, I'll say like that. I really like that film because one filmmaker has made three films using the same thing, and he was able to give three times three different very interesting films using the same thing. 21 Grams, Amoroso, and Babel. A lot of films, it's happening there. I think I am planning one, so let me reserve that.
Largely what I was saying was just a reaction. Yes. And I was sitting and getting restless, and you used the word reactive, so I couldn't just control myself and I reacted. But largely it was just a comment, and what I was saying was, at times we romanticize struggle, and I don't know how, but because maybe we are an imperialist nation, we have a history of subjugation, we kind of glorify struggle, and at times struggle is not struggle with simple unprofessionalism. And we urgently need to differentiate the two. So that was just a comment. That at times classical romanticism has struggled. I'm sure you were not saying that.
I understand
what
you're saying.
But it just gets the garb.
Let me just respond to that very quickly. There's a line in Peter Brook's Mahabharata where I think Yudhishthir said, if I'm not mistaken, "I see an age coming where small men walk the tiny earth." I think this is that age. I think we are living small lives. I think we don't have, the age of giants is over. The last of the giants in cinema, the last of the giants in classical music, the last of the giants in almost any field, unfortunately, are dying out. And we are living very small, tiny, dry, unromantic lives. And I like romantic lives. You want romance, you romanticize what you can. It's simple. You don't want a romantic life, live a dry life, live a straight life, live a practical life. For someone like me, who... who likes the idea of living out a story, of having romance in my struggles, in my relationships, in my friendships, in my enmities, and everything. Yes, I do romanticize almost anything I can, because we are living very, very unromantic lives, and it reflects in our cinema.
Thank you. Can I just abuse the power of the mic and ask, what was Gulzar Saab's answer to your question, if you'll share it with us?
He couldn't remember.
At what point of time do you decide to trash the screenplay?
What time we decide to trash the screenplay? All the time, unfortunately. You know, even when it's about to be shot, only a week ago Raju was saying that, yeah, it works. Man, we've been working on it for 2 years and you've shot 30% of it, but there's that anxiety that remains. But you know, we are like nature. It's a matter of the survival of the fittest. So anything that's weak, we go with an idea, and when we find that it's a lame idea, like as ruthlessly as nature, we kill it. We are supposed to kill it. If we try to sell it, then we are in trouble. That's a disaster. That's corruption. If it's lame and we discover it to be lame, we kill it. But there is no formula.
No, but the flip side, Abhijat, yeah. And I think my favorite example is Lage Rao Munna Bhai, I was very briefly involved on trying to work with Raju on it, but then I couldn't go through with the film because I was going to be busy with Jaane Tu, but there was something else. I really felt there wasn't a film there. The fact of the matter is that if you believe in something, then no matter what anyone tells you, whether anyone tells you to thrash it, don't. If you see it, and if you are willing to put in the work that is required to find it, then you absolutely don't thrash it. But do you have that in you to back it all the way? Do you see something that nobody else can, and how much of your life are you willing to put into showing it to people?
Yeah, well,
so,
you know,
that's a flip side.
No, I understand. But Abbas, what I'm saying is that you yourself,
yeah,
kill it.
No, if you
right?
honestly
see,
believe
if
then,
Abbas
yes.
had just gone with, you know, for fame and popularity, he would have written the second one. While he believed that there's no film there, he would not be able to stand here and speak with such conviction. The reason he is able to do that is able to maintain that fire is that he thought that, well, it's not there and I'll not do it, you know.
I think what happens is there are moments where you constantly feel that it's not working. I think the best thing is to keep it away then and revisit it after a couple of months. And if it's still working for you, then I think it's working.
Hello. My question is actually an offshoot of what Mr. Abhijat said about finding like sources or material to refer to. And I was wondering, like, this is the question aimed at Mr. Hirani and Mr. Abbas Tarwala. Like, Abbas, you said you had like a lot of mentors. You had like two in particular that you helped guide you.
All right, so we'll have to go slower.
Okay, so sorry, I was wondering if it's possible to refer to or get a copy of your produced scripts for us like aspiring writers to like read and refer to, because if you go online you'll find like produced scripts of all the major Hollywood films, all the Billy Wilder films, the Ingmar Bergman films, you'll find Fellini scripts. So is it possible for us writers to like actually get a hold of like a Munna Bhai script? Can we like read?
Yeah, actually we are in the process of we have been talking to a couple of publishing houses, and I think in a couple of months we would be publishing both these scripts.
Okay, that's pretty much
also to the best of my knowledge, I think passionforcinema.com periodically puts out the scripts where the producers do not have no, you will not do it.
Abhijat.
Well, yeah, that is aimed at filmmakers, and I'm sure that process is interesting to them. But yeah, the fact of the matter is, if you just want to read completed scripts and to whatever, one, I think increasingly now, because we have finished scripts, people are looking at publishing them, and a few interesting scripts do find their way to some internet sites. So let's keep our fingers crossed that we get to see more work.
Well, this is going to be very academic, but I'll briefly tell you, there's an unbelievable place in Austin, Texas, called the Harry Ransom Humanities Center, which likes to collect all your trash, all the trash that the writers discard. So you find actually the early drafts of Death of a Salesman and of Streetcar Named Desire. And believe me, I've read these drafts and I have learned a hell of a lot. Actually, if anybody is familiar with or a fan of Streetcar Named Desire, I saw Tennessee Williams's pencil scribbled note on the script telling the typist, change the name from Tom to Stanley.
So we actually have cartons full of drafts lying. If somebody is willing to take up the job and do it, we'll be more than happy.
Abhijat, of Indian script writing, okay? The craft on one side, and on the other side, ethics, originality, okay? And when Abhijat gave us that analogy about the DNA of a film, okay, so taking it further from there, why are these, we have learned to make jokes about films which have copied from DVDs, you know, other DVDs which have been a process of script writing, we joke about them. But what about these other bits of molecules that come creeping into the DNA, like in otherwise delightful films? I will take examples of your film since you are there. Abbas, in your utterly delightful Jaane Tu, a very important thing that koi nahi aane wala hai, tumhe hi karna hai. Father's not going to come, you're the one that's supposed to do it. Remember that? I loved it, but it's coming from Harry Potter. It's coming from there.
Hold on. What? koi nahi aane wala hai, tumhe hi karna hai, vis-a-vis with reference to what?
The dream about the horse.
Yeah.
And that the father's going to come and save you and all that.
Yeah. Oh.
You remember that?
Oh, you thought that was Harry Potter?
I thought, no, it was. I know, I'm sure you didn't.
Well, considering...
Oh, please,
considering
please don't
the fact
laugh.
That, considering
it's,
the fact that the entire
it's,
film...
It's horrible if we laugh and just to shut me down, because we...
No,
we
no,
know.
No.
I'm not saying you went ferreting about in Hollywood films to look for that. Or that Raju went to One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and got that prostitute thing. I'm not saying you went...
Let me answer this for Abbas.
But I'm just saying, please let me complete my question. I'm just saying, because Abhijat said we need journals... And all that. I think we also need to increase our experience. We are just experienced so much by other films and other books and journals and quoting from other Hollywood script writers that we just, I see all these bits and I'm saying they are otherwise very delightful films.
See,
Abbas, I didn't think it was Harry Potter.
I didn't think it was. I'm not crazy, so don't all of you laugh like with
Abbas. Please, because you said that the second time I want to refer to it, please understand that they were laughing at how completely befuddled I look. The one thing I do not do when I'm asked a question is use laughter to... No, one thing I do not do is use laughter to ridicule a person who's asking me a pertinent question. That was not what they were... They were laughing at how completely flummoxed I look. Nobody was laughing at you.
I think our experience is very limited and these things automatically creep into our...
I understand that, but the fact...
Let me answer this, Abbas. I think... let me first say that all the people on the stage at the moment of time could have made 6 films a year. We don't. Because consciously we don't actually pick up from DVDs and make films. But how do we write? We write actually from our references, from what we've seen in life, what we've experienced in life, what we've read, and what we've seen, you know, possibly also on DVDs. But there's never a conscious effort. I'm sure Abbas wouldn't have consciously picked it up from there. Deep subconscious, something might have been there, which might have come from. There's been, even with my films, it's happened a couple of times. There's an episode where I actually ended up using something from Sharad Joshi's Neha Sharad's around somewhere. But I know there was no conscious effort to do it. It subconsciously, you know, came in because we pick up from life. So we would have made many more films, actually,
we've
just picked up from DVDs.
We also have influences. For example, the one thing that I have actually, and I'm going to sound ridiculous admitting it at this forum, but the only thing that I've actually copied, if you want to call it copied or been inspired by or wanted to capture in my film, the only actual reference that I will admit to having thought about is the scene where the way when Jay cries at the end, that scene, I so categorically, explicitly voiced it to my team. I said one of the most incredible crying scenes I've ever seen in my life is in Godfather 3, where Al Pacino breaks down when talking about I killed my brother, I killed my mother's child, and he starts crying. And that entire scene, it's just on his back, on his shoulder, and just the way he kind of scrunches him up, and you know he's crying and you feel his anguish. And I wanted to see if I could capture that with an actor. So when I use references, and I do sometimes, some things inspire me, but those you won't catch out because I don't use them as shortcuts or whatever. Call them tributes, call them moments that inspired me to try something, to flex my own muscles. The one thing I do not do is use shortcuts from anywhere to just to bridge gaps in my story. I personally don't do that. But like Raju said, what lives are we leading? How many of us are living truly interesting, inspirational lives? Our influences are, if we are lucky, books and films. If we are unlucky, television. Not in the sense, but if you're moronically just watching that all that, then that becomes your biggest experience. How will you not be influenced? So you cannot escape influence. What you do is you watch yourself. What you do is you don't lie to yourself. What you do is you don't consciously say, I will take this, that fills this gap in my story. I don't do that personally.
I found it really very good. And I felt that it was inspired by a few other films. But I said, it's a great adaptation. And around the same time, Goldie Saab was alive then, and we were discussing the film with him. Now, Goldie Saab has watched a lot of films. So he had an idea that where the inspiration might have come from. So he mentioned about those inspiration points. But I was also discussing his film, Tere Mere Sapne. Now, he was candid enough to admit that Tere Mere Sapne, I got the inspiration from this source, and this. This part of inspiration came from my personal experiences, from a friend of mine who had this kind of experience, like his character of Dr. Jagannath Kothari. Problem with all of us is that we don't admit this. We always try to browbeat anybody who says that, look here, you know, you are inspired by this. We should admit it candidly, and then it shows that we are great people. This non-admittance, and that friend of ours, she's so right. If you admit it, there is no problem. Sure. But we don't admit it. That's how we become thieves.
Sir, wait a minute. Wait before you clap. Guys, wait before you clap to this. Yeah, well, you know, I will not admit to anything until I'm tried. Do not stand there and say before the trial that you are accused and you better admit it. What the hell is meant by saying that you admit to something when I can say with total integrity here that I have never stolen in my life?
Fine, you believe you, we trust you. But when you suppose you have taken some inspiration from somewhere, admit it, that's
but
all.
Why does a hypothetical situation arise? If I have it?
No, no.
Okay, I think we are diverting, we are just going away from.
Can I ask?
Right now we have to solve the problems of script writing.
Mr. Dalwala, I would...
Let's not get into a blame game, let's go.
There's somebody here who's been waiting for a long time to ask a question. Can we please do this one first?
My question is to Abbas Dalwala and Abhijat. When Abbas said that the screenplay are essentially a structure, and I completely agree with that. But my question is, the content has to be Indian, but what about the form? Do we really have to look up at the American structure? I mean, when we define a structure, what does that mean? We follow that Hollywood American structure, and after 10 or 15 years, because they have tired with their structure, and it's new in Indian cinema. So when after 10 or 15 years, we will have tired with their structure, then what will be? So my question is, what about depth? If we didn't have a structure in our earlier cinema, because that was, you know, primarily a dialogue driven, and we didn't have long cinema culture, so why shouldn't we try to develop Indian signature in narrative? I mean, narrative means completely cinematic narrative.
Basically, you're saying, why should we be dependent on copying somebody else's structure? You have to understand that the laws of dramatics that Abhijit teaches, and that I refer to as integral to structure, these are not, we're not copying a structure of Hollywood films. These are laws of dramatics that have evolved independently across various civilizations that have a storytelling culture. Just like, for example, a lot of screenwriting ideas of Western writers are more available to us, like Abhijit mentioned in his talk, and a lot of ours are not. That doesn't mean that we haven't had really interesting, inspirational, exciting moments where our fathers, whom we do not know, as Abhijit says, had some great ideas that we would be truly proud of. We just don't know. The fact of the matter is that the laws of dramatics have not come from Hollywood cinema. The laws of dramatics have independently evolved, often in complete isolation, similar across the Greek storytelling culture, across the Indian storytelling culture, and across wherever storytelling became a culture, the idea of a beginning, middle, of an end almost spontaneously formed. The interesting part is, a while ago I attended a conference in Goa that the British Council had held, and I was desperately unprepared that day, Anjum. And I just said, listen, I'm not really ready over here, but let's just take up something. Let's just take the greatest epic in Indian mythology, the Mahabharata, and let's see if it follows the three-act structure. Let's see if it follows the plot point A, the hook point, the plot point B, the going towards the resolution, the protagonist. And it was incredible. Slowly, the whole group got involved, and we could explore the entire Mahabharata in terms of, excuse me, Sid Field's three-act structure. Does it mean that Vyas was, Ganesh was copying Sid Field's structure? No, it doesn't mean that.
Well, you know,
this is just a rule of the thumb. It's a reference. It's a reference for if you want to do that kind of structural storytelling. This is what tends to work. It's a guideline. Please, if you have it in you to break it, to explore new forms, to explore new techniques, power to your tribe, more power to your cause. And I say it's great. I wish people can do it. I wish people can accept it. But in the meanwhile, to keep a staple diet going, here's something that's available to you. And it's not always restrictive. It often sets you free to really imagine because you're anchored. So if you choose a structural storytelling, often it anchors you and really unleashes your imagination rather than restricts it.
Well, you know, I'll answer in one sentence. Tarantino has said this, that a story has to have a beginning, a middle, and an end, but not necessarily in that order.
Go that way.
So Tarantino stole that. Then.
Could you please explain the art of convincing a producer about a script like Munna Bhai MBBS?
And we see a script in your hand.
Yeah.
So much is being talked about Indian mythology in Mahabharata. I thought I would be doing injustice to Telugu film industry if I go back without mentioning this. That way back when black and white movies were made, Telugu film industry did dare to make movies, mythological movies, with greys, in the sense white and black overlapping, where you had movies like Lankeshwara and Ravana Brahma, where the devotee of, the great devotee that Ravana was glorified, and a great ruler that he was. His only sin was that he carried away Rama's wife, okay? And that is white creeping into black. And coming to black creeping into white is, we had great movies of Sri Krishna, Krishna-Arjuna Samvadam, okay? Where you had argument between Krishna, the god, and Arjuna, the man, okay? And we also had Ramanjaneya Yuddham, where Rama and Anjaneya, God and his devotee, the greatest devotee, they were fighting on a particular topic. So again, there was black creeping into white.
I must say that the audiences then, and the Telugu audiences then, were clearly more evolved than perhaps our audiences are now, and perhaps we are not brave enough to find out, but I think then we should be proud of that era and those audiences. And maybe we should give our own audiences a chance and maybe explore things a little more than we do.
Well, Mr. Tyrewala was talking, which he said in passing, about how Indian traditions of storytelling are a lot about black and white. And I don't think so. You were absolutely right when you talked about the Ramayana and Mahabharata, and she's talked about that in Telugu film. But I think that there's a lot of gray in Indian literature and in Indian theater traditions from in more indigenous ancient times to modern Indian theater. We've just had a session on Vijay Tendulkar in the morning. I mean, starting from the more classical texts like the Rig Veda, which says neti neti, to the whole idea of a godhead, or to a classical Sanskrit text like the Geet Govind of Jayadev, which completely turns around both gender and devotional stereotypes or current whatever things, along with folk tales, legends, love ballads, how the Ramlila is performed in a lot of places. So there really is a lot of gray already existing in Indian literature, Indian performance. I think a lot of the times we don't see it, one, because we are unaware of it, ignorant of its existence, because we don't understand the language and the idiom in which it's communicated. The other thing I wanted to ask you about was when you talked about black and when you talked about the villain and the manner in which the villain has changed. That's also because I think we'll all agree that the Indian script exists in a certain larger political and social context. So that when the villains were the moneylenders and the smugglers, were talking about a certain kind of a Nehruvian socialist.
One is not debating that. One is just saying that that is no longer available. That
absolutely.
Is all, one is not but passing
think,
a judgment
I think
on
what
that.
Is more, I think what is more sort of perhaps we need to look at is that black and white, which, as you said, that there's no villain anymore and we're going into an era of grays. I think we should also ask ourselves whether it's really a gray or it's a more kind of white pink, because look at the kind of questions that we're dealing with. You talked about relationship issues, about a certain kind of expression of personal angst, about a certain kind of, I'd also like to bring up here the rise
of that is really not fair.
The rise of the NRI city as the set for all this kind of gray stroke white pinks whatever this thing. I think that we should, you talked about questioning your own emotions and questioning the individual's emotions. I think it's really important that we also question our own politics as individuals, as well as a community of people who are writing and producing stories. Because there's a lot of gray in society, even today, there's always been. And a lot of it has come out in films in India, and I'm sure it will continue to, but I just wanted to make this point.
I think that's what this whole session is about, to try and get us to explore.
As writers, we are being judged by people who want to make films. So my question is the quality of writing. We always, in India, we talk about subjects. What is the subject of the film? As opposed to what the quality of writing. I thought your film, Jaane Tu Ya Jaane Na, was a piece of very good writing. But people will judge it because, it was just a love story. I think Jabbi Met was an example of very good screenwriting. But it will never win a best picture because the subject that people think.
The answer is yes. Okay.
When a writer takes off his cap and wears a director's cap, so all three of you, all four of you are like writer directors. So what is that difference that you feel in yourself and how do you go through that change?
You want to know the ego level? I think I was even talking to my, I said I didn't work under him, but I consider him as my mentor. Govind Nihalniji was there in the morning. I was talking to him. We were talking about the same question, being a writer and a director. He was a little surprised that I have written all my 10 films and I have directed all the 10 films to some decent level. So when we were talking about that, he said, how is that? How do you feel? I said, you are a writer. I will even consider him writer par excellence. See, where is the line? Who can put the line? Every director is a writer. You take it from me. Seriously, that's how I feel. If you are not a writer, you cannot be a competent director. Seriously, there is a writer inside you when you direct, and there is a director when you are a writer, if he is a writer director. I don't write my shots separately. Seriously, when I write my dialogues, no, I think everyone will be doing like that. See, it's all, one can't separate that. That's how I look at it. But I started my career as a, I'll just finish this. I started my career as a journalist. I used to write short stories. Then I used to work for Indian Express. Then I joined K. Balachander. Probably that writer is the first thing that I learned because I didn't learn the craft of directing. Then I joined director. When I joined my mentor director, Balachander, I started learning things only with the tool of me being a writer. I can't separate myself me being a writer at any point in time. So that's how I look at this.
Abhijat and Raju, aapke liye ek sawal hai sir. Aap documentation ki baat kar rahe the script ko leke. इंटरनेट पे अवेलेबल कराना है या काफ़ी सारी बातें आप से मुझे वो बात की बात है जबकि फाइनल ड्राफ्ट पढ़ा जाए मुन्ना भाई का मुझे एक सवाल करना है कि वो क्षण कौन सा था राजू जी और अभिजात जी जब एक ऐसा कैरेक्टर जो आज भुला दिया गया है महात्मा गांधी आप लोगों को लगा कि उसको लेके हम हीरो बना सकते हैं गांधी जी को हीरो बना सकते हैं और एक फिल्म को कमाल का स्क्रीन प्ले के शेप दे सकते हैं वो कौन सा क्षण था राजू भाई
Abbas
wants to answer this first. Okay, Abbas.
Okay, I'm actually was in a bit of a privileged position to really see the birth of Lage Rao Munna Bhai in Raju's head. After Munna Bhai MBBS, Raju was struggling with two separate story ideas. He was, and I'm going to ask his permission now that they're probably not necessarily relevant. Can I tell him the original Gandhi idea that he was struggling with?
Of course.
So he wanted to make two films. One, he really, really wanted to make a film where he kind of communicated what he felt about Mahatma Gandhi's ideals to a current generation and what it means. And his chosen device at that time was that what if Mahatma Gandhi had given a job to somebody? And that person wakes up in today's times, okay, for whatever reason he was trying to find a device that would make somebody who stopped functioning when Gandhiji gave him a job and woke up today and had to do Bapu's bidding. But he has to do it in a current context. And that story wasn't quite falling into place. He was going on. And he wanted to make another Munna Bhai story because obviously it had done well. And there was pressure from viewers, from everywhere that it was a necessary thing. You had to make a second Munna Bhai. So he was struggling with lots of storylines that weren't quite falling into place. And he was working on both of them, not quite sure what he wanted to do next. And one day he just said, what if Mahatma Gandhi appears to Munna? Okay. And I remember, even though I was the one who later, after a lot of struggling and seeing him struggle and trying to struggle with him and being not in the right space of mind, even though I told him later that I don't think you've got a story there and I don't think it's going to happen. My first reaction is, I can't believe you managed to find an idea that takes Munna Bhai to the next level. So I was really in a bit of a privileged position because he was working with two stories that weren't happening. And one day he just went, oof, and there it was.
He said it all.
You guys believe that you need a certain formal training in writing craft or, I mean, how many of you are from the film school that believe that you have to be from a film school to approach a particular subject or theme?
Abhijat, since he's a teacher, I think he's the right man to answer this.
You know, well, I don't think that you need to be in a film school, right? I think it's possible to educate yourself. Really speaking, the only time I regret in my life is when I was writing a film with Vidhu Vinod Chopra, who was a very senior director. Renu Saluja was editing the film. Binod Pradhan was the cameraman on that film. And I thought that my job was to write, then go home, have two beers, and eat chicken biryani and go to sleep.
Sounds like a good life.
And it's damn good life, but I regret not learning other aspects of my craft. You know, if at that time, those evenings could have been spent, you know, learning editing, learning finer things about music. And that's the only period that I really regret. Once I totally involve myself in writing, when there is that immersion, then I think we all learn more from viewing cinema, viewing life, being observers. Somebody mentioned politics, having politics of some kind, having a sense of history of some kind, becoming more socially aware. These are the kind of things that matter much more than
sort of formal training. That's what I believe.
Experience of editing, how much does it help in writing a script?
When I first applied to the Film Institute, I applied in the direction course and I wasn't selected. Then somebody told me that too many people who apply in direction, why don't you apply in editing? And it'll be easier to get in. I knew nothing about editing then. And I, next year applied in editing and I got in actually. Now I feel blessed, actually I did that. Because I've suddenly realized, while writing I'm editing constantly. While writing I'm constantly seeing, even I'm looking for this stray word, is there an extra word I want to knock it off? Because I know this will spoil the pace of the film. While shooting I'm constantly editing. In fact it's a joke with a lot of actors who, especially with Baman, who, actors who take long pauses, sometimes I keep saying, just compress it. Because I see it in cuts. Actually, for me, the film flows in cuts, constant. While writing, as Vasan just said, you see the film. As a director, you see the film constantly in your head. So you are, I see it in complete images. So I think a basic knowledge of editing for every writer, we were just talking about education. I think it's education of any sort for a writer is good. You should know about direction, you should know especially about editing. I think it makes a big, big difference.
And I'll try to complete that with an anecdote, though I've sort of run down anecdotes about Raju and how obsessed he is with editing. I think for an entire night he was editing with Ketan Mehta, and then in the morning they came out of the editing room and they're having a cup of tea and they're chatting, and Raju looks at the other guy and he says, "Yaar, tu out of sync bol raha hai."
We've been talking a lot about standards, and that's what my question is about. I'm a little confused as to whether standards are relative or absolute. I mean, filmmaking is a very subjective medium. Everybody has an opinion. But I'm just curious, a lot of times I see films that are considered brilliant just because they're a little above average. I want to know how you as filmmakers judge yourselves. Do you judge yourselves relative to other films, filmmakers, or is it an internal standard that you hold yourself to, or perhaps a combination of that? As you go through the creative process, how do you know that this is a good idea or not a good idea?
See, I think we all should answer this, but if I will begin by saying that I constantly remind myself that am I smiling? Am I crying with the script which I'm making? I'm trying to only satisfy myself and nobody else. I think it's a mistake to try and make a film where you try to satisfy an audience you think, which is as large in a country like ours. You have a particular kind of audience in Bihar, you have a particular kind of audience in Bombay, and if you're trying to satisfy somebody else, I think that's the biggest trap. The only thing I think I make an attempt is to satisfy myself.
For me personally, I think I completely agree with Raju. I know it's going to sound how convenient to say this in front of a large group, but the fact of the matter is, every time I've been done with a film, I've completely lost interest in it. And this includes everything that I've done, regardless of a film like Munna Bhai MBBS. Ask Raju, he will vouch for me on this. This film was coming out, everyone was excited. We had a dirty feeling we had made a good film, but it was unusual. How would it do? It didn't open that well. And on the first couple of days over the weekend, Raju and Dilip and a lot of people who worked on the film were touring all the theaters and just trying to gauge the audience reaction. I was not part of that group. I couldn't bring my, and I have not ever been, I couldn't do that on Jaane Tu. I had to go necessarily on a bit of a tour and all. But the fact of the matter is, from the time the film got completed and I got my final okay from my audience, which was like two days before, since that time, in its completed form, like completed, locked in one go, uninterrupted, I have never watched the film, and I have absolutely no motivation to. I'm done with it. So for me, it is, the process has to be enriching, because the result never does anything for me. Sure, I would like it, it's a hit. It makes other stuff possible. It makes it easier to do your next work. So one is invested in the film doing well. But for me, as soon as I'm done with the film, I'm done with it. So if I'm making it for an audience, then it's really sad, because I can't enjoy the audience reaction. So I have to make it for very, very personally, for me to enjoy telling the story.
I think what I generally decide when I make a film, that I should be satisfied, definitely. But at the same time, when I make a film for the market, I cannot forget for whom I am making. So that's constantly there in my mind. I really would like to forget that, but it's always a fight. See, I can't just fool myself that I am doing only for myself. I know at the end of the day it has to go to the market and it has to reach the viewers. But why I am telling you this is that when I make a film, also I know for whom I am making. I cannot forget that. So keeping that in mind, what do I do with my films is that I have very, very strict do's and don'ts. I don't want to feel bad about I have done this. As I told you, one of the films what I did a comedy track in my earlier film, second film. Till date, I'm expecting some way can I edit that from the negative. No. That's what my aspiration or my interest or wish should be. See, that's the only thing I can proudly say that I've been extremely strict. Thereon, I really learned from my mistake that I will not do what I don't like. Right. But at the same time, I know for whom I am making the film. So I can't forget that. Yeah. But when I did a small short film which won the National Award for me, not all the feature films, it was fully, I like some short story. I really like that short story. I know it has got that universal quality. I did that as a short film and that got me the National Award. So who the audience? If my audience is the market, then I have to keep them in mind. That's how I look at my films when I make them.
The only thing that I find in terms of standards to maintain them, and you know, we are human beings and we are going to fail. I promise you we are going to make some bad films if we try. If we continue to try writing, it's going to happen. But I think that there are three commandments which my screenwriting teacher, Vidhu Vinod Chopra, taught me early on, telling me that they are Ingmar Bergman's commandments. But I've researched Ingmar Bergman subsequently, thoroughly, and I don't find them. So I think they are Vinod's commandments. But
they are the lost commandments of Ingmar Bergman.
But I have totally try to follow them to the best of my very fallible self. The first one is, you will entertain, because no cinema is going to be a sociological treatise, you know, or a political speech. It's important to entertain people, spend money to come to the theater. But the second commandment is very critical. You will not sell your soul when you entertain. Now, there's a critical commandment, so you can't sell your ass and just entertain to make money. You know, you have to follow your own value system, your own ethics in life. It cannot be in conflict. Your cinema cannot be in conflict with what you believe in. So that second commandment is that you, when you entertain, you will not sell your soul. And the third one is, you will treat each film as if it is your last film. So you write that film, and if you die, you should be okay. You should not think that, okay, I'll write this one for doing this, you know, I'll write this one for money, and the next one will be the film that, you know, is my passion project. No, each film has to be treated as if it is the last thing that you'll ever write.
Okay, I'm not sure if it sets a very good moral on stage for me to actively disagree with your third commandment. I work very, very differently, and each one of you, I think, should choose what works for you. I would say do every film like it's your first film. Honestly, that I think is going to work a lot more realistically. You start with thinking that you've got it figured out. You think you've got your technique figured out. You've got storytelling figured out. God help you on that project. If you start every film with the fear of God, bloody hell, I have to start that shit all over again. You know, starting with exterior, city, road, day, and knowing that 120 pages lie unwritten. Unless you start with that fear, unless there's a healthy fear that I don't know how to do this. And at the back of mind, knowing that you've done it a few times, that will keep you going. But unless you're paranoid, your subsequent work will not be as exciting as your first work. And we have seen this so often in so many directors, which is why they don't put in the kind of work in their second films, stuff like that. Why I'm a huge admirer of Raju is because he actually put in more work in his second film than his first. He actually put in more work into the story and finding it and developing it and fine-tuning it. And I think that it's a lot more crucial to make every film as if it was your first film, because then you will bring that fear, that passion, and that keeps you alert, it keeps you involved, it keeps you motivated. Otherwise, the day you start thinking you've got it worked out, you've got it figured out, you start dying a slow death. So just take your pick, I suppose.
I think we'll end with that. Thank you very much.
Nice meeting
you. Wasn't
it? I love you.
Catch up with you.
Sure.
Very nice.